Hey guys, what's up? Welcome to session two of Music Theory. Today we are going to dive into how chords are made. In the first session, we covered what music theory is and what it isn't. And then we said the purpose of music theory is to be creative. So today we're going to learn where chords come from, how chords are made, and let's jump right into that with a little bit of review. So let's start by taking a look at what a major scale is. Now, in the first session, we said that the formula for that is whole step, half step. What on earth does that mean? Well, if you're not sure, go back, watch that introduction, Worship Plus Music Theory video, come back to this, but I will show you how to play it quickly on here. Now, on this harpeggi, we swapped out for one that doesn't have the letters because I don't want you to be confused by the letters. I want you to just see the distances. Remember, whole steps move this direction, half steps move up and down. And what we need for building chords is we need the foundation of do, re, mi. And we said that is whole step. Let's start at this C note here. Whole step, half step, whole step, whole step, whole step, half step. Now that gave us do, re, mi. Now, where do chords come from? And consequently, where does harmony come from? I know for a long time it was a mystery to me how anybody could just make up a harmony part. It's like certain singers could just start singing harmony. People would accidentally sing harmony. And that happens for a variety of reasons, including what's called the overtone series. And there's a lot of different things that happen there, but the foundation of it is very, very simple. Chords and harmony, which those two things are very, very similar. Don't think of chords and harmony as something very different. Those are not two different skills. Those are not two different branches of music theory. They're the same thing. Whenever you're playing more than one pitch at a time, you are playing a harmony, and they could also be called chords, right? This would be a chord if I play two or more notes. So that would be a C chord. Now, where do chords come from? Well, we have our scale. That's step one. Step two is this. A chord is built out of every other note from a scale. So let's say I want to make a C chord, and I'm in the key of C. If I go every other note, one, two, three, that's a third, one, two, three, right? Though it's music theory is always the measurement of the distance between notes. We're just going to number them. One, two, three. If I play one and three, now let's add another one. Let's, again, every other note, let's skip four and go to five. If I hit one and five and three, now I've got a C major chord. Now, that doesn't have to stop there. I could go more. Now, when I play three notes, they're what are called triads. A triangle has three sides, and a triad has three notes. But what music theory did, especially jazz theory, which is another kind of branch of music theory, it said, you know, if we could go every other note for the whole triad, what if we went another note, right? And so you could do something like this. Here's one and three. We're going to skip four. There's five, and then six, seven. And if I hit all those notes at once, now I get what is called a C major seven. And as you can see by the name of it, and that's the biggest thing that I want to get across to you in the video, when you understand where chords come from, and the fact that you number do, re, mi, instead of thinking do, re, mi, let's actually say it differently. Let's say one, two, three. So do, re, mi equals one, two, three. And if we play those notes, every other note at the same time, we get a chord. A basic chord is three notes. An extended chord is four notes or more, right? So we could play one, skip two, three. That would be our next note. One, three. One, two, three, four, five. That would be our next note. Play all of those together. One, three, five. That's our chord. And then we could add seven. Now we could go up again, right? We're on seven. We could go back up. Everything with a dash is that same note again. This is eight, or our octave. Eight, octagon has eight sides. Octopus has eight legs. An octave is eight notes away. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. That's the same note. One octave higher. Think of it like a guy and a girl singing. They can sing the same note, but the girl sings higher and the guy sings lower. So if I'm on seven and I skip eight, nine, and I could play C9 if I just take all these notes, every other note, one, three, five, seven, nine. That is where chords come from. Chords get made from every other note in a scale. Now, if you have seen any music chord charts, you've probably seen something that said C minor, and we haven't covered that yet. So let's talk through a couple of the most basic families. We're going to talk about the major families that you're going to see when it comes to chords and what they mean. Now, we are making major chords right now. We made a C major chord. It was 1, 3, and 5 from the scale that we're playing in. But let's talk about how to make a minor chord. Here's the rule for minor chords. You always flat the third. Now, all that means is that whatever note is your third note in the scale, 1, 2, 3, you just move down a half step. So here's C major, or a major third. And if I move this note down a half step, that is a minor third. Now, in minor chords, here's the rules. The third is always flat. The seven is always flat. In major chords, nothing is flat unless it says so, right? So maybe it says, maybe the name of the chord is C major 7 flat 9. That would mean you would go find 9 and then you would move it down a half step. So in a major chord, nothing is flat. In minor chords, you flat the third and you flat the seventh. Now, let me show you what that looks like. Here's a major chord, C major 7. Now, let's go back over our numbers here. Again, starting on C. C, every other note, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So here's my major 7. If I wanted to play C minor 7, I would flat the third, and I would flat the seven. It would sound like this. Probably hard to see there. 1, flat third, 5, flat 7. So minor chords flat the 7. Now, we have two families. Let's talk about the other major family and then two kind of side note families, pun intended. So some other side notes, right? So the two major families we've talked about so far, major chords, minor chords. The third family I want to talk about is dominant chords. Now, this is something that I wish somebody would have said to me earlier in my musical journey because I thought they were the same thing. Dominant chords look like this, and I'll make sure that I put it on the screen right here for you. Dominant chords are a letter. We've been playing C chords this whole time, and a number. They don't say major. They don't say minor, right? C major 7 is what we've been playing. 1, 3, 5, 7. But the chord C7, that is what is known as a dominant chord. And here's the rules for dominant chords. The 7 is flat. Let's play it. Here's our regular C chord. Here's our 7. And we have to flat just that note. That is a C7 chord. Root, third, fifth, flat 7. There you go. So those are called dominant chords, and that's the third main family. And those are the three main families. The three main families of chords, three types of chords you're going to see the most. Major chords, minor chords, and dominant chords, right? And I'm going to put all of this at the bottom so you can see it really, really clearly. Make sure you're looking down there right now. Major chords, nothing is flat. There's the rule for major chords. Minor chords, flat the third, flat the seven. Dominant chords, flat the seven. There's two more families. We're not going to spend a lot of time on them because you don't hear them much, especially in modern praise and worship music. That is augmented chords. Those sharp the five. Now, when you sharp a note, we've been saying let's flat a note. That means we go down. When you sharp a note, you go up a half step. Augmented chords sharp the fifth. And then the final type of chord is diminished. Diminished chords flat the fifth. There's our main chord families. Now, you're going to see some other things that come up. We're not going to belabor this video getting all the way down in the weeds on this. You're going to see things like sus and add. There might be some other kind of notation, just that depends on who wrote the chord chart. But those things, the suspendeds and adds and all of that stuff, those are other rules that are very easy to look up. There's lots of videos. We'll cover all that stuff at a later time. But for now, you need to remember the three main families. Major chords, nothing is flat. Minor chords, flat the third, flat the seven. And dominant chords, flat the seven. That is where chords come from. That's how they're built. Now, what is the reason for taking time to memorize those three things? Well, here it is in a nutshell. If you memorize those three things, then the name of the chord tells you what to play. Now, that's amazing because my dad bought me a 10,001 Guitar Chords book when I was a teenager, and it made me want to quit because who can memorize 10,001 chords? Nobody. And it really discouraged me. But I was fortunate enough, he actually bought two books that day. He bought the chord encyclopedia, chord dictionary, whatever it was named, 1,001 chords, 10,001 chords, whatever it was, a discouraging amount of chords. But he also bought a book called Chord Theory. And when I read Chord Theory, I learned what I just taught you. And it gave me hope because now the name of the chord tells me what to play. The name of the chord isn't just some random designation. It's actually the formula, or you could say it's the recipe that tells you what ingredients the chord needs. And when you understand that and you know where the notes are on your home instrument, now you can literally create from scratch any chord without having to look it up. And that's an amazing feeling because when you can do that, you can confidently say, like I'm going to say right now, I know every single chord. I know every chord on every instrument that I know how to play. That's an amazing feeling. And that's why it matters where chords come from. Now go practice.